Hi, this is Robin. I'm going to talk about movable type as part of our introduction to typography. So before we get to movable type, just talking a bit about reproducing text in general, here are some different ways of reproducing text. So one way is to reproduce text by just writing it out. That would be what we would call the scribal tradition. And so at the top here, you see some Carolan or Carolingian minuscules from the 9th century coming out of the what's called the Carolingian Empire, which has kind of got a combination of different European, modern European countries in it, which would include Germany and France. So it's coming out of that area, and it's Roman influenced. And then here we see some black letter type, and both of these are produced with a tool directly by hand, which means that you'll see expression of the hand in them, and that every single version is going to be slightly different. It's going to be labor intensive. The Carolingian minuscule also is more time consuming to produce, and so that's something you'd want to take into account too, how the letter forms themselves are structured. This is the foundation of the lowercase form of letters that we use in today's world when we're working with Roman letter forms. Another way to reproduce text, which is a little bit more efficient, is woodblock printing. So on the lower left here, you see an early specimen of woodblock printing. And the way that woodblock printing functions is that you have a larger area, a larger surface that you can fill with text or images or both. And the way that this type of woodblock printing would be produced is that you would carve it all in one go. You would ink it and then lay papers down on top of it and pull it. And so, of course, one of the big contributions that China makes to printing is the invention of paper. And this type of paper that's used is a kind of more of a mulberry. It's a softer paper, which is very good for, very pliable for hand rubbing technique. It's also called xylographic printing, by the way. So movable type was actually developed in China as well by Bi Sheng in 1045. And type is always a response to need and available technology. And so he was trying to figure out if there was a way to make printing more efficient by separating out the items. And so what you have here is what makes movable type is that each character can be pulled apart and rearranged as opposed to being carved all in one go like this. So these would be independent, and the way that he used clay or ceramic to produce these. So the thing is that, as I mentioned, type is often a response to need. So there was a rise in literacy, which is also connected to a rise in printing technology, a rise in literacy in China during the Song Dynasty, and so he was trying to meet that need. The thing is that it did not have the same cultural impact in China as it did in Europe. The arrival of the printing press in Europe with movable type created a massive cultural shift. And that didn't occur in the same way in China, and there are a number of different reasons for that. So when we're thinking about the history of type, different cultures develop type differently. And I think it's a mistake to think about it in terms of like just available technology. It also has to do with what people want to do with the technology, and what other factors are present, like how the language itself is structured. So Chinese, for example, is a logographic language, and so these different character forms are strung together differently than an alphabet. It just functions differently. So to give some context for Roman type, thinking about the Gutenberg press, and this would be the culture that would be responding to. So on the left here, you see a manuscript from Belgium in 1260, and that's using water-based pigments and sometimes gold leaf decoratively, and the material that it's printed on is a vellum, like an animal skin. It's a very, very thin animal skin, which is not really as efficient as paper. Paper begins to make its way into Europe more commonly at around this time. And so, of course, that sets a stage where printing can begin to occur. And it makes its way into Europe, I believe, via the Islamic world stemming from China originally. So here on the right here, I just wanted to put this in a bit, because the scribal tradition in Europe, and the way that it would work is that you would have often groups of scribes that would work together, and that reading itself was actually a much more communal activity than it is now. Because people often shared books, weren't a lot of private ownership of books available. So as a result, people would often read together or be read to, and that when people read privately, they would often have an oral connection to that reading and in fact either read aloud to themselves or even just move their vocal cords as they read. So the way that they interacted with text at that time was different. But what's happening on the right here is that these are collected marginalia, things that scribes wrote in the margins when they were reproducing text. And it's a lot of complaints. I am very cold. That's a hard page and a weary work to read it. Now I've written the whole thing. I apologize for the bit of a swear. Now I've written the whole thing. For Christ's sake, give me a drink. Which is not something you'd expect to see in a Bible. But this is connected to a long history of complaining among people that make books. And so I thought I would just put it there. But also just to recognize that it was very difficult work, and you would dedicate huge amounts of time to producing a single copy of a book, which would then be about worth the price of a car, is my understanding. There were some much more expensive variations, but even the cost of a car is quite expensive for a book. Okay, so these are some examples of the print culture that Gutenberg's press was responding to. So on the top here we have De Re Militari, which is kind of a combination book. It's got some woodblock and some manuscript, I believe, and it's a bit of a how-to, but it's intended to show people how to wage war more successfully, but some of the technology that it's featuring is completely fantastical. It's not something that's actually yet available to people. And so for me, I think like when I first began to look at this particular era, I wasn't actually that interested in it, if I'm being honest. But when I look at it now, I think it is actually quite fascinating, because they're dealing with an era in which they're cobbling together newer and older technology, and also sort of imagining what types of things might be possible for them in the future. And in many respects, that's actually where we are right now. We are a combination of print and digital, often interacting with one another, intersecting with one another. So that's a kind of how-to guide. Here is a woodblock book from 1465, which is a Bible. And so I just want to draw your attention. So this would not be independent characters. This would be carved together. I just want to draw your attention to this banner here, the way that this type swoops like that, which I don't know how impressive that looks to you, but the thing is that's something that's quite easy to achieve if you're doing something by hand, if you're drawing something out, or if you're carving something out, or if you're laying it out digitally on a contemporary layout program. But it's very, very difficult to do with mechanical moving type. Because mechanical moving type is laid out on a grid. And so I'll just give you a tiny little glimpse at what that would look like. So you've got these items that are laid out in a kind of a matrix. So to make that kind of swoop on a page becomes very challenging. And so this is about the end of an era prior to when the grid becomes very key to European layouts. So that is a woodblock carved piece. And then these are woodblock playing cards. And again, these are produced by hand. So what you're seeing here, you're seeing different types of letter forms. This is that black letter again, and this is more of a semi-black letter, but you're seeing somebody's actual hand, the mark of their hand, or the rhythm of their line. Not really their line, but the rhythm of their work is visible in this. It's not mediated by technology in the same way. It's almost like seeing a picture of someone's writing, right? So it's a bit different than when we get into mechanically reproduced type. So mechanically reproduced type for the 42-line Bible that Gutenberg made with Schaefer, who was trained on his press, is a refined version of textura, which means it's a variation on a black letter style of type, and that's because it's coming out of Mainz, it's coming out of a German tradition. The thing to remember here also is that this is not drawn first. Somebody didn't sketch this out and then cast a mold of it. It's carved. And so because it has this carving tradition to it, First of all, the people who began working with it were often adopting technology from industries that were already going on in Europe. So goldsmithing is one, and then I believe there's a connection to like wine presses also. But the kind of very thick proportions that you see here have partly to do with the fact that the technology can't support something that's finer than that. And also this is a reproduction of what a human hand would write. So in order to do this, there were a few things that he had to do that were tricky. So the important thing actually is not the movable type in terms of his contribution, because as I've mentioned, movable type is already invented. And in fact, Korea also has a really important contribution to movable type as well, which I'm going to talk about in a separate lecture. But what's important here is that he's making very sort of shifts to things like metal alloys. A really important contribution that he makes is developing a type of ink that can sustain sort of multiple pressings, and also developing a typeface that's going to work with an alphabet. So as I mentioned, Chinese is a logographic language, and so it's structured differently. An alphabet, when pieces of an alphabet come together, you have all these different shapes, and you want them to look like they're strung together naturally. Your hand will automatically put spaces between letters that are more or less optically consistent, or should do that. But if you have sort of metal blocks, again, just looking at these metal blocks, if you have these metal blocks, it can become trickier to make the spacing look consistent. And so partly what he's doing is looking at adjusting for that, which is called fitting. And then also thinking about sort of practical considerations, like if you have a word that's repeated very often, maybe you can make an abbreviation of that or a pre-existing solid glyph of that, so you don't have as much typesetting to do, and so on. So what he did to make this first set of type is 290 glyphs. There were 47 capitals, 63 lowercase glyphs, 92 abbreviations, 83 ligatures. Ligatures are when you have two characters that are literally tied together into one glyph. So these two Fs would be one. Ligatures and five punctuation marks. So that's kind of more what he's doing. And of course, because books were so valuable, to come up with technology that would allow you to reproduce many copies of the same book, even if it was a kind of slightly time-consuming process, was meaning that you had discovered something that would be worth a lot of money. Now, there was some disagreements or difficulties financially between Gutenberg and his backer, Fust. And so the accounts differ as to who is sort of at fault here. But basically, Fust takes over Gutenberg's printing press with the press runner, Schaefer. And they begin the imprint. So Gutenberg is not actually involved in the first, what are called incunabula, that his printing press produced. So this here is the Biblia Latina from 1462. And so if you just take a quick look at this type, you'll notice it doesn't actually look that different than a manuscript. So it's an imitation of a manuscript. And there are also these decorative letter forms. And so what they've done here is this is movable type. And then they've left a spot here to fill that in with woodblock printing. And this is really nicely done, actually. And that's a tradition that goes on for a while. People will leave a blank space and have a professional calligrapher come in and decorate that space copy by copy, or a sort of woodblock intersect with it. So you have combinations of technology working together to produce books. It's not like there's a very sharp turn where we go immediately from a xylographic and scribal tradition into movable type, but movable type does make a really strong impact in Europe, as I mentioned. And that's not the case in all countries. Not all countries experience the technology that way. So for example, Japan gets a hold of movable type technology both from Korea and from Europe in about the same 10-year span, tries it out very briefly, and then its commercial printing industry completely rejects it and remains and works with continues on with a woodblock printing tradition, which it develops really successfully into a commercial industry, very similar to the trajectory of printing in France. You get really similar rates of literacy, similar rates of popular printing, and so on. So there's not really a hard and fast rule for how the technology needs to intersect with the culture, but just to say again that it happened to intersect with European culture in such a way that it made very big shifts, both politically and culturally. Okay, so I'm just going to tell you this little tiny story. I'll try to tell it really briefly. With Fust and Schaefer, what happened when they first went to sell their Bibles. So they had these in Canabala, and they put them in a suitcase, and they took them to Paris to sell them, and the Parisian authorities intercepted them, and in looking at the suitcase, found all these editions of a book that looked the same, close to exactly the same. And it just didn't make any sense to them how that could possibly be the case, and so they believed that it might be witchcraft, and so they arrested Fust and Schaefer and nearly killed them with their books. Fust and Schaefer talked their way out of it, and in fact went on to open up an office in Paris, which is significant, and I'll talk about that in a moment. Okay, so here are some sort of Albrecht Dürer, who some of you will recognize from art history, taking a look at mapping out black letter type. And what you see here with this L is him looking at how you can take something that's organically made with a hand and map it out into a modular structure. So you can sort of begin to see already the type of thinking that comes along with the printing press, which again is very heavily gridded and modular and mechanical. I think these are both really pretty specimens. And here he is working with an emerging font at the time, a style of type, which is called Roman or Latin. And that, of course, is connected directly to the Roman tradition. So I'm going to talk about this for a second because it is actually quite important. And there's a kind of an interesting thing, which is that you would assume that since early printing technology in Europe stems from Germany, or what we would now call Germany, that a German style of type would become sort of the more popular style of type that we would all use today. But in fact, it gives way very quickly to a Roman form. And there's a couple of reasons for that. And this connects partly to why Fust and Schaefer opened an office in Paris. Paris was a really important center for aesthetic production. So French calligraphy was very prized. There was a very strong scribal and calligraphic tradition coming out of France. And also the French court, the French king invested in type design early on, sort of saw potential in the technology. Again, this happened in other countries. In Japan, the shogun there also invested in it, but it just didn't take off in the same way. Now, the thing is that France draws very heavily from Rome, partly because of that Carolingian connection. And so Venice, for example, in the 15th century was a very important cultural and financial center. And so you get a sort of combination of French and Italians working together, French people, for example, working in Italy. So some of the early important French type designers are French people working, for example, in Venice or in what we would now call Italy, producing letter forms that are drawn from their tradition. And so, in fact, it's design that makes that cultural mark on type that lasts until this day. We still look at letter forms from the 15th and 16th century coming out of Italy and France, and they look to us like relatively contemporary fonts. We still use them to typeset books today. So that's kind of an example of the power of design, but also in a cultural investment in design. Okay, so this is going back to black letter again. I don't know if you can hear that little rattling sound, but it's my cat eating. Okay, so here's black letter. This is a style of type that you might very likely have in your own system as feta fracture. It's not from 1875, but this particular variation is. So these are different styles of black letter. If you take a look, they've got a lot of differences between them. This one here is not an important one in particular, this one that's called Bastard Fat by Jonathan Barnbrook in 1995. I'm putting this here just to introduce the idea of kind of like a postmodern variation on traditional letter forms. So for example, the reason that it's called Bastard Fat is partly, I mean, it sounds rude, it's a play on words, but the idea also is that Bastarda is a style of black letter type, and so he's referring to them, fat refers to a particular type of weight. And so he's playing around with language there and historical reference, But if you take a look at these carefully, they don't look like perfectly traditional letter forms. They're sort of like a bit cartoonish. Sorry, I just need some water. Just one moment. I haven't mastered editing, so you're getting whatever happens. Okay, so we looked at black letter, and this is an example of Roman. So this is a Adobe Jensen, which is based upon the designs of Nicolas Jensen, who is a French type designer who worked in Venice. And these are some, I'm just going to give you a little tour of Roman type. Okay, so this is a traditional serif face, so it has these serifs on it. We'll talk about those in a little bit. This here is one of those ligatures I mentioned to you, so this is designed to not have these two letter forms crashing together, so they're sort of tied together into one glyph and the I doesn't have a dot. If you type out the word fish, for example, in Illustrator, you'll watch the dot on the I disappear probably as your software converts the F and the I into a single glyph. Ampersand, keep an eye on that. And then we'll also take a look at this lowercase a. The other thing here, I'm going to come back to it. The other thing here with the text figures and tabular figures is that quite a lot of Roman faces have more than one set of numerals. Text figures are designed to flow with the text, and tabular figures are designed to be scanned with your eyes so that you can notice mathematical sums and so on. It makes it easier for you to organize that. I've lost the word mathematical, but that's what we're talking about. Okay, so just to go back for a sec, we had black letter, we had Roman, and then we have italic. And so if you take a look at that A, if you take a look at this lowercase a, you'll notice that it's shifting, and it's going from a double story A to a single story A. And if you italicize type, especially from this period, you'll notice that there are actually some really big shifts that go on in many of the letter forms. And that's because an italic actually comes from a completely different tradition than Roman type. It has a different lineage, and it was originally used independently. You would just typeset entirely in italic. It's not the way that it's functions now as part of a family where you have both Roman and italic for emphasis. So you can still see that, and so you'll sometimes hear about something having a true italic, if a font has a true italic. What it means that instead of just the letter form sloping, they actually switch into a proper traditional italic form. That ampersand, also you'll notice, makes a big shift there. Excuse me. Okay, and then I just threw this in as an extra. There's also ornamental type. An ornamental type is pretty much what it sounds like. It's designed to be looked at and more than to be read. Oops, I went backwards instead of forwards. Okay. So I'm going to go over a couple of pieces of terminology. One is typeface. Typeface is the design of the type of the letter forms themselves, so the kind of the plan, the sketching it out. And the font is the usable form of type from the foundry, and that could be either digital or metal, but either way it's something that you can use. So here we have, for example, Adobe Jensen again. And here, this is an original specimen of Nicolas Jensen's font. And this is kind of a bit magnified. You can see how rough some of the technology producing that is. Now, if you get, for example, Adobe Jensen Pro Lite Caption, which is a particular font, it's telling you the foundry, which is Adobe, a digital foundry. Jensen is the design, Pro is the format, the weight is a lightweight, and the caption could refer to an optical size. It's kind of telling you sort of what you should be using that type for based on its weight. So, for example, in your systems, it's quite common that you'll have something called Bodoni 72. And that a lot of people, when they're first beginning, it's an interesting looking font. They'll use it as body text. They'll use it to do a paragraph of text. But actually, Bodoni 72 means that you're supposed to set it at 72 points. okay, and then the market here is Typekit. Typekit is kind of a subscription model and is licensed through Adobe, is my understanding. So there is a marketplace sort of situation here where instead of buying a font in the good old days, you would, not really good old days, I'm kidding, but in the good old days you would buy like a big whole bunch of metal type in different sizes and it would be expensive and that would be one of the several fonts that you would use forever. Now we use many, many different digital fonts, and so it's more common for people to want to license, and so Typekit is a licensing situation, and it was acquired by Adobe for Creative Cloud subscribers to use as part of a feature to sell. Okay, so these are different aspects of typographic anatomy here. I am going to go over just a handful of these features and then cover a little bit more in another week. So the first thing that I want to draw your attention to here is the baseline. The baseline is the invisible line that all of the type sits on and keeps it nice and straight. There are bits that hang down below the baseline, like a tail or an ascender, but that baseline is sitting there. And now there are several different heights that are at play here. Excuse me. This here is the cap height, meaning from the baseline to the top of the uppercase letter. And uppercase letters have a much more consistent baseline and height than lowercase letters, which are kind of more all over the place. In some fonts, an ascender like this will be higher than the capital, and in other cases, they will maybe be a bit lower. If you take a look at Futura, for example, the lowercase L and some of the ascenders are in different spots than the cap height. When we're talking about X height, what we're talking about is the difference in the height of the uppercase letters to the lowercase letters. So X height refers to the height of a sort of basic lowercase letter here. So if you take a look at Helvetica, there's not that much difference in a height between the two of these. And in Mrs. Eves, there's a very big difference. And so as a result, this has a bit more of a shape to it as a word, which in some respects could make it easy to read, for example, on a printed page. And this tends to set really generously and big, so it works really nicely, for example, on screen. So this would be an example. These are both classic examples of X height differences. So Helvetica has a generous X height, and Mrs. Eves has a small X height. And the last thing that I will mention here before I close this is the axis. So the axis has to do with stroke modulation, and you can see that this is lining up these two thinner areas, which have to do with how a pen in a right-handed person's hand would form an O. And the way that it's tilted like this is referring to the slope that a right-handed person has in their lettering. So this axis, for example, which you don't need to remember, would be referred to as a humanist axis. And there are other type of axes. So I would just say over the next couple of weeks, keep your eye out, see if you can spot serifs, see if you can sort of notice things like X height, see if you can figure out where the baseline is, and familiarize yourself with these terms. Okay, talk to you soon.